My name is Carrie Gray. Carrie Gray is a Black disabled woman, and there's power behind that. In the United States, 1 in 4 in the Black community have some type of disability, whether that's visible or invisible. Historically speaking, organizations and institutions have shown us that they want to identify with one thing and build power around that, build influence and access. And I get it, right? So this idea that you have disability rights, you have women's rights, you have LGBTQ rights, and those kind of different pockets are really building a strong narrative. But the thing that I find to be harmful is when we're not building in coalition. Because the reality is that you have people like myself who are Black, disabled, and women, and so many other things. And when you live at the intersections of all three of those, then you can't split your political and social dynamics between these different groups. It doesn't produce real results of freedom, and it doesn't produce real results of access to employment and other opportunities that you're looking for. I'll give one example on this. So the Black Lives Matter movement, when it was created in conjunction mostly with a lot of young folks. What was unique about this particular movement was the intersectional philosophy that was built upon. The folks getting up and saying, we are not just fighting for one narrative, but we are specifically fighting for folks who are on the margins. We are fighting for Black folks who are also LGBTQ, who are women, who are femme, who are trans, who are disabled. They named it. They saw, like, their people across the country and said, I'm fighting for all of you. Not just some of you, not just the ones that have traditionally gained power and access. And that gives me a lot of hope, because no one wants to be left behind.
Good afternoon. I am so honored to be with you today. I am Darren Walker, a brown-skinned African-American man with a bald head. I am wearing Lucite glasses. I have a brown tech shirt and a brown sweater on. I'm in my office here at the Ford Foundation. My pronouns are he, him, his. This conversation is one I have been waiting for because it brings together two critically important constituencies of the Ford Foundation and indeed our democracy. The disability rights community and the voting rights community, both essential if justice is to be realized in this country. And let us for a moment reflect on this idea of justice. Thomas Jefferson said to his friend Samuel DuPont that the work of America was to create a just nation. And while it is very clear that Thomas Jefferson did not practice what he preached, I want to hold him to his words. And I want to ensure that this country is accountable to all of us to ensure that justice is realized in America. And in a democracy, at the core of that justice being realized for everyone is the right to vote. It is regrettable that today, something that is so fundamentally nonpartisan, the idea of voting in a democracy, the idea that everyone should be encouraged and we should be celebrating, the idea that everyone and we should aspire to ensure that everyone has access. The reality is that today, deeply, deeply regrettably, I believe, at least for me and my colleagues at the Ford Foundation, this is a contested idea. The idea of voting has become contested. Now, it has been contested throughout history, so this is not new in this country. But there is no doubt that there are efforts underway that seek to disenfranchise and not allow this country to live up to its ideals, that everyone participates. And let us not in any way retreat from our commitment to what justice and democracy looks like. I think Carrie Gray's powerful words in the video we just saw, that we live intersectional lives. And this idea of intersectionality that some have sought to mischaracterize, to undermine, is not something that we can retreat from. The idea that we in this country, particularly those who are marginalized and who have been left behind, are now demanding their full rights, demanding accountability so that people with disabilities can have their aspirations, just like everyone else, their aspirations and dreams realized. So we at the Ford Foundation consider ourselves enormously grateful and fortunate to work with many of you, to learn from you on the journey. And I personally want to thank so many of you because you have taught me, you've become my sheroes and heroes as I have been on this journey, as we at the foundation have. And I'm so grateful to Erica Wood, Rebecca Coakley, our colleagues in our events program who put on this program today, and to all of you for what you do. And I only want to be here to encourage you, to lift you up, and thank you for having the courage, the determination, and the unwavering commitment to ensuring that indeed this idea of justice is realized in America. And today's conversation, I hope, will be a contribution towards that effort and serve to inspire and remind especially those of us in philanthropy who are committed to democracy. Our mission at the Ford Foundation includes the idea of strengthening democracy. There can be no democracy in this country without the disability rights community, the ideas, the laws, the policy, the racial justice communities, rights, policies, the harmonization of our communities, understanding that we all must be committed to each other in order for justice to be realized. I think today's conversations, the panels that we're about to hear from, will help inspire us, motivate us, and mobilize us in the coming months and years ahead. So thank you. Thank you so much.
Hi, my name is Sean Gold. I am a Black man who has a white tracheostomy breathing tube in my neck. I am 22 years old and I live in St. Louis, Missouri. The 2020 election felt different for a lot of reasons due to the pandemic. Since I vote by mail, and that's the most accessible for me and many in the disabled and chronically ill community, voting in 2020 didn't feel that different from other years. However, it was sad to see that method get attacked so hard. As for an urgency, it definitely was one, but I feel like that's always the message just to get people to show up anyway. Voting did help me make so many amazing connections with my community. Since organizing was all virtual, everything was accessible, and I hope some of the aspects will continue with future elections to continue to allow my community to be involved. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Rebecca Coakley. I have the privilege of being the U.S. Disability Rights Program Officer in the Office of the President here at the Ford Foundation. I am a redhead white woman with an abundance of freckles. I am wearing tortoiseshell glasses, a black blazer, and a white t-shirt. I would like to thank our CEO, Darren, for his longstanding support of this work, and also his really strong commitment to embracing risk and reflecting honesty. It's something that we talk a lot about at the Ford Foundation, about the willingness to dig in and have the tougher conversations that often people consider taboo. And before the last several years, I don't think I ever considered democracy and the need to participate in our democracy as a taboo subject. Hearing our colleague on the last video share that the 2020 election, because of the pandemic, enabled a level of participation never seen before by the disability community is something that really resonated with me. We saw unprecedented engagement across the field, whether it be registering, showing up at the polls, engaging on campaigns, even considering running for office. And I think it's because for the first time, the rest of society saw what it was that we experienced as people with disabilities when it came to accessing the vote and the importance of maintaining the maximum amount of flexibilities to ensure that people could participate in our democracy. So at this moment, we are wrapping up our inaugural year of the US Disability Rights Grantmaking work and watching our investments really start to grow. Philanthropy's longstanding neglect of the disability community has resulted in a field that, while endlessly creative and resourceful, really lacks capacity. And it is a field that really cannot grow to its full potential because of the dangerous and historic legalized poverty so many people with disabilities face. It's something that Darren and I talk about frequently, the fact that one third of GoFundMes in this country are for uninsured, unreimbursable expenses faced by disabled people. That's why our principal focuses for our grant making will be field building and economic justice, because we know that you can't move the needle on social justice or poverty or democracy without centering disability. But the work itself is going to take some creative partnerships. And with that, I am thrilled to pass the mic to my partner in this work, Erica Wood from Ford CEG team. Erica?
Thank you, Rebecca. I'm so grateful for your partnership, your leadership, your friendship. My name is Erica Wood. I am a senior program officer on Ford Civic Engagement and Government team. My pronouns are she, her. I am a middle-aged white woman with shoulder-length brown hair. I'm wearing a black blouse and a black sweater. And importantly, I'm wearing a necklace that says vote. So Ford Civic Engagement and Government team has been working to integrate disability rights into our democracy and voting rights strategy with the guidance of Rebecca and Darren, Catherine Townsend, who's also on our team here at Ford. It's been a journey, but it's been incredibly important and powerful. And I've just been learning so much along the way and so excited to be able to share some of those learnings with you all today. We on our CEG team at Ford believe that movements must be strong to both withstand the attacks and attempts to divide and oppress our communities and to do the hard, sustained work necessary to realize long-term change. And we believe that movements are stronger and more impactful when they are inclusive, and that strong partnerships and deep collaboration are essential to realize that long-term change. And we believe that the voting rights movement is made stronger and more effective and more impactful when it integrates and includes disability rights. And that disability rights advocates and activists must help lead this work now more than ever, as Darren said in his opening remarks. So to this end, we've been supporting disability rights leaders to have a seat and a voice in the broader voting rights and civil rights communities. And we've been encouraging and supporting our voting rights and civil rights organizations to integrate disability rights into their advocacy and engagement strategies. We've worked to make connections, build relationships between and among these communities. And in 2020, as Rebecca said, voters with disabilities turned out in force. This high turnout shows that disabled voters have resolve to make their voices heard and to fully participate. And it is our work to try to make sure that resolve is realized. We think that this also demonstrates a growing collaboration between voting rights and disability rights organizations. working together to ensure that voters are able to participate, regardless of race, class, geography, gender, and disability.
Thank you so much, Erica. There still remain significant challenges for the disability community. It's important to remember that all attacks on the right of any community to access their civil rights, including voting, will disproportionately impact the disability community because we exist in every other community. It remains unchanged today in 2021, 31 years after the Americans with Disabilities Act, that 80% of polling places have at least one impediment that prohibits or inhibits people with disabilities accessing the polls. It really is not that far from the 1988 election when I rode on the back of my dad's power wheelchair to the polls, and I had to walk up the steps at the church that we were assigned to vote at and submit his ballot for him because the polling place, because it was a church and not eligible or not required to be ADA compliant, was inaccessible. But I don't want to stay focused on the challenges because it's important, as Erica noted, to remind ourselves that the disability community is strong. I want to highlight a quote in CAP's recent report on enhancing accessibility in US elections. As Erica pointed out, in 2020, we turned out in force. Over 62% of disabled voters cast a ballot in the November 2020 election, compared with 56% of disabled voters who participated in 2016. As Justin Dart, father of the Americans with Disabilities Act, used to say, "Vote as if your life depends on it, because for disabled people in this country, it really does." This is the backdrop for today's event.
So let's get to it. We are joined by some amazing, fierce advocates and activists, our partners in this work from these communities, those who are working at the intersection of disability rights and voting rights, as well as by a really great group of funders who care about equality and justice. We're so excited to dive into this conversation with all of you. We hope you leave this conversation with a better understanding of the experiences of voters with disabilities. We've already heard some of that. We'll hear more. A greater appreciation of the power of integrating disability rights into voting rights and democracy work, and a commitment to take this learning into your work moving forward.
We are now going to hear from Curtis Chong, a voter in Colorado, in a video created by our partners over at the National Disability Rights Network. We'll then hear from Nse Ufot, Mimi Marziani, and Doug Kruse in a conversation moderated by Mia Ives-Rublee. And following that, we have a panel discussion in response to where we go from there. If there are any questions, feel free to use the chat. Thank you again for joining us today.
Why is it that voting systems do not have the same ability to talk faster and as clearly as the computer in my pocket vis-a-vis either the iPhone or the Android phone? We feel like we're not getting the best designs with regard to the accessible equipment at the polls.
Curtis is an Asian American man. He is wearing a blue floral shirt and sitting in front of a pink wall.
My name is Curtis Chong. I am totally blind, and I live in Aurora, Colorado, privately working as a technology consultant for the blind after retiring, working in information technology for something on the order of 40 years. Back about 8 years ago, when the iPhone started achieving some prominence within the blind community, the state I was living in had a talking voting machine. And when we went to evaluate that machine, we found out that the quality of the speech, first of all, you couldn't speed it up to have it talk very quickly. And secondly, the pronunciation of individual words was quite garbled. So I went to the Secretary of State's office in that state and I said, you know, my iPhone can talk faster and more clearly than your expensive voting system that you probably paid a mint for. I said, this is wrong. Something has to be done to fix that, because we now know that synthesized speech or text-to-speech technology is very good and can produce quite acceptable and almost human sounding speech. The characteristic of blindness and other disabilities are usually met with sympathy and I feel sorry kind of attitudes. And the only way we're going to fix that is if people with disabilities participate in the process and get up and say, this is what we want. These are the problems that we're facing. And frankly, the mechanism in our country through which we influence policy at its basic level is the vote. One vote matters, really. And people really need to get back into the idea that my vote counts. And the only way to influence what happens is to get out and vote.
To learn more, go to voterswithdisabilities.org.
Thank you so much, Chris Chung, for your important words on including disabled people and all processes of the voting and voting access. Hello, my name is Mia Ives-Rublee, and I'm the director for the Disability Justice Initiative at the Center for American Progress. My pronouns are she, her, and I am an East Asian woman with short black hair and a gray sweater. I helped co-author a report with my colleague Danielle Root titled Enhancing Accessibility in US Elections. Before my work at CAP, I spent several years working in voter advocacy world and even more time advocating for disability rights and justice. I'm pleased to be moderating this conversation on disability and curb cuts to the ballot box. I'd like to briefly introduce our panelists today. We have Dr. Doug Kruse, professor at Rutgers University within the Program for Disability Research. Mimi Marziani, the president of Texas Civil Rights Project, and Nse Ufot, chief executive officer at the New Georgia Project. Thank you all so much for joining me on this awesome conversation. You know, we saw, as Rebecca said, we saw unprecedented percentage of disabled people voting in the November 2020 election. 62% of disabled voters cast their ballot, compared with just 56% in 2016. Dr. Kruse, you helped author a report titled Disability and Voting Accessibility in the 2020 election. Your report showed that there was about a 3.6 percentage gap between the turnout of people with and without disabilities, which is lower than the 6.3% in 2016. What were some of the problems that disabled people encountered around voting access?
Well, I'm very pleased to be part of this. I'm Doug Kruse, as you say. I'm a white male, white hair, blue sweater. I use he, him pronouns. Very glad to be part of this panel. This is immensely important. My colleague Lisa Ensure and I have done a lot of work in this area, working with the, you know, doing surveys with the Election Assistance Commission, but we've actually been doing work on this way back to the 1990s. I'm a good news, bad news kind of guy. Let me just briefly say, I'll start with the bad news is that people with disabilities are still less likely than people without disabilities to vote. There is this stubborn gap of several percentage points that's existed for a long time. And there's also bad news that, as we found in our most recent Election Assistance Commission report, that people with disabilities, about 1 out of 9 experienced difficulties among those who do vote, about 1 out of 9, 11% experienced difficulties in voting, which is twice the rate among people of people without disabilities. So that's the bad news. The good news is, that turnout is improving for people with disabilities. There was a improvement of, 5.9 percentage points in voter turnout between 2016 and 2020 for people with disabilities, which is higher than the increase for people without disabilities. The other bit of good news is that there is actually improvement in accessibility. We did a survey for the EAC in 2012, which found that 26% of people with disabilities who voted experienced difficulties in voting. That number came down to 11% in 2020. And we have several indications that there was real progress in voting accessibility. That was not just all due to the expansion of mail voting. Part of it was due to the expansion of mail voting, but a lot of it was due to increased accessibility of voting in general. So there is some good news that people with disabilities are more likely to vote, and it is easier to vote than it has been, but there's still a lot of work to do, absolutely.
Thank you so much for talking about sort of the increases in accessibility. We've seen, you know, differences in states on how accessibility is experienced, because many of those aspects are controlled by state elections and by county. So I would love to move on to Mimi and hear about what was going on the ground in Texas. We heard a lot in the news and would just love to hear your perspective.
Absolutely. Thank you, Mia. Thank you, everybody, for being here today. I am Mimi Marziani. I'm the president of the Texas Civil Rights Project, a community lawyering organization that envisions a fair Texas. I'm a white woman with blonde hair pulled back in a ponytail. And the most marked piece of my appearance today is I'm wearing some cool earrings a friend got me from San Miguel that are beaded and very colorful and lucky for this conversation. So I'm going to pick up on that good news, bad news frame, because I think that that is apt for what we've seen in the last couple of years in Texas. There is bad news. I think the bad news is that Texas, by many measures of political scientists, is one of the most difficult places to vote in the country for everybody. And it becomes even more difficult for populations like people with disabilities that have traditionally been excluded. And on top of that, we've seen, especially in 2020 and 2021, pointed attacks at against the disability community, which have been honestly quite shocking. The good news is that in response to those attacks, we have seen a ever-growing movement that is, to use some of the beautiful language we heard in that introductory video, truly intersectional. And we have seen a movement come together that involves people of color, people with disabilities, young people, other groups that have traditionally been excluded from the electorate, really working together in one voice to push back against these new restrictions. And I mean, that has come out in hundreds of people testifying at the Capitol this summer, thousands of people showing up at rallies, including people with disabilities, both in the audience and as speakers. Also shows up in things like our Election Protection Coalition here in Texas, which has more than 100 groups and represents all of the largest groups, at least, of advocates for people with disabilities. So, you know, I think that we really have seen both sides of the coin. And, you know, I guess the best news of all is the story doesn't have an ending yet. We are continuing to fight in Texas. And I personally do believe that our movement is getting more diverse and more thoughtful, and we are really kind of stronger all coming together.
Thank you so much, Mimi. Nse, I want to hear about your experience in Georgia. You know, I actually did some work in Georgia, so I have some love for the state. So what were you seeing on the ground?
Yeah, peace everyone. I am Nse Ufot. I'm a brown-skinned African woman with a sun yellow dress on and enormous black plastic frame glasses. I'm a little hoarse today. You know, we've had lots of developments in the great state of Georgia over the past couple of days, including the election of a new mayor. So I've been in celebration mode. I'll tell you this, what we are seeing right now in Georgia can only be described as a full-on attack on voting. And those of us who live and work and love at the margins are being deeply impacted by this attack on our elections. What we're witnessing is a shift in ideology and a shift in demographics as Georgia barrels towards its future as the first state in the Deep South with a white minority. It's not only the votes of people of color that are being attacked. It is a sort of ideological attack on folks and groups who tend to vote moderate to progressive. And part of that is because the writing is on the wall and there's nothing scarier than like desperate people, desperate men. And we're looking at this current version. We have single party rule in the state of Georgia. They, despite the fact of like a long and a recent history of voter suppression, we had overwhelming participation in our elections because that there were so many accommodations that were made for the pandemic. It just so happens that the accommodations that were made to make it easier for people to participate in the pandemic also helped our neighbors and siblings and those of us living with disabilities. And because the people's will was reflected in the results of the elections, which was yay for us in our community. Those who are currently in power sought to break the machinery of our election. And so right now they have passed what is known as Senate Bill 202, which is a law that has essentially made 50 new changes to how Georgians vote, including creating 5 new crimes, misdemeanors, and felonies for voting and voting related behavior, such as now you can go to jail and be fined if you fill out an absentee ballot in the presence of someone who isn't a spouse, parent, or child. As you can imagine, those of us with caretakers, right, or who are caretakers, are likely will be impacted by this. And so our communities are coming together and responding. There's a significant backlash that we are witnessing, not only in Georgia, but across the country. And it's because we're winning, but because our communities are showing up and participating. And we should not see the backlash as justification for taking our foot off the gas.
Beautifully said, beautifully said. I wanted to talk a little bit about sort of what are we doing to push back and to increase access for disabled people and creating, you know, curb cuts to the ballot, basically. You know, in CAP's report on enhancing accessibility in U.S. elections, we suggested about a $8 billion investment through the fiscal years 2022 to 2026 to fund important programs that will improve the election access and spur innovation towards accessible voting, including a new accessible office at the EAC, a National Resource Center for Accessible Voting, comprehensive federal grants for studying barriers to voting for people with disabilities, developing non-technical and technical solutions through new Democracy, Technology, and Resiliency Laboratory at an appropriate federal agency with disability access expertise, you know, investigating electoral barriers and accessibility audits, to just name a few. Reducing barriers to voting will take a very concerted effort. From your all's perspective, what are some of the takeaways you want people to know to prepare for 2022? Everybody's talking about it on the, you know, in the news and communities about this fight in 2022. What do you say to people when we're trying to reduce barriers for disabled people?
Well, I can add a couple of comments there. First of all, I would really enjoy hearing what Mimi and Nse have to say. You're doing important work. The proposal, I think, is great to make a lot of investments in We need a lot of investments in making elections more accessible in a variety of ways. And I guess the point I'd make, and this may sound like an obvious point, but it's not always. Sometimes people say, well, we just need, you know, to do X and that will solve it all. Or we just need to do Y. And what we need to do is X, Y, Z, and all the other letters of the alphabet. There's no one size fits all. The expansion of voting by mail helped turnout of people with disabilities. People with disabilities are about 10 percentage points more likely to vote by mail than people without disabilities. But it's not for everyone. Blind people in particular, we found that over 1/5, 22% of blind people who voted by mail said they had difficulty and needed someone else's help in doing it. Well, that's not good if that's the only option they have. So we have to keep in mind that one-size-fits-all approach doesn't work. We really need the more options, the better. The more options, the better. The more options you have, the greater the chance that a person with a particular disability will find an option that works well for them. So I think that's an important point to make.
Yeah, I really, really appreciate that.
Yeah, I usually am loath to like repeat something that a previous panelist has said, but Douglas is absolutely right. It's all of the above. That this moment, and I'm also really mindful about like how I use the language, but there's an urgency that I think it's really important that needs to be communicated. And when you are trying to, you know, stop the bleed or stop like a grievous existential sort of blow or wound to something, then you're trying all of the things. And I think that this moment is demanding, requires us to be experimental and entrepreneurial, and that we dig into best practices, but it's all of the things, right? Because we're talking about the process, the act of voting, the act of participating in our democracy. But let us be mindful that we vote because we choose elected officials who go to Washington, D.C. and to our state capitals and to our city councils to do our work. Right, that we are in the middle of a pandemic, and that, you know, nearly a million of our residents and neighbors are no longer here with us, right? That there are actual things that we need to win for our families. Folks who are living with disabilities in our state of Georgia are challenged by a whole bunch of things, including the fact that we haven't expanded Medicaid in our state, that there are 12 hospitals in rural Georgia that have closed, that people have like doubled, and in some cases tripled the commute to get to a hospital. Over half of our counties don't have OBGYNs, right? And so the things that we are fighting for are real and they're urgent, and interfering with our elections makes it more difficult for us to reflect, have the will of the people reflected in the results of the election. So we can't get the policies that we need to live the lives that we need. Yes, I think it's being entrepreneurial, experimental. I think it's technology. I think it's culture. I think it's lobbying. It's the meat and potatoes of legislative change. But this is an all hands on deck moment as each of us thinks about the policy areas that we want to have effect the change on, and thinking about our ability to do that being attacked right now in 48 out of our 50 states.
Yeah, I agree with all that. I'm gonna be such a lawyer and follow y'all with five bullet points. One is the Americans with Disabilities Act is a really powerful tool. And I think has been noted by a couple of speakers, it is still, there's all sorts of governmental agencies that are not in compliance. And so huge shout out to Coalition of Texans with Disabilities, a frequent client, partner of TCRP. But, you know, suing under the ADA is a real tangible way that we can continue to bring about change. And we have ADA claims and a variety of active lawsuits right now, including against the new voter suppression bill passed just a couple months ago. Number two, yes, Texas is also hell-bent on insulating power in the hands of those people who hold it right now at the exclusion and to the disadvantage of everybody else, particularly folks on the margins. And it is a hard slog at the state level, but I do want to just point out that we need to continue the statewide advocacy. And we were able to mitigate some of the worst pieces of the suppression package because of that broad-based active coalition this summer. And also huge shout out to friends from Georgia who sadly fought this fight ahead of us. And we got some important pointers from them. Three, local reforms. In Texas, like many other states, the process is quite decentralized. And that means there's a lot you can do at the local level. And, you know, one of my favorite projects that was with the Coalition of Texas with Disabilities and Rev Up and the Texas Organizing Project and a whole bunch of groups in 2020 was actually both a lawsuit and an advocacy campaign in San Antonio because they were refusing to put up signage for curbside voting. And so not only did we sue them, but we also got people out. We printed our own curbside voting signs and we called the press. We made a whole show of putting them up ourselves and having, you know, members of the community at Kinko's when this should be a government obligation. So the local reforms can make a tremendous effort. And we totally won that fight. And then education, you know, I think that we've talked about this as well. But, you know, especially as there are new rules that are making voting more difficult, we have to educate folks about their rights and about how to get through the rights, get through these rules. And believe me, I'm the first to say they no one should have to be hopping over these new barriers. But, you know, we can also empower folks and together as a community, break them down as best that we can. And then finally, I think lifting up something that both NC and Doug said, you know, we have to be aware, I think, of our own blinders. I mean, none of us, you know, all of us only come with our own lived experience at the end of the day. And so that's why we need these coalitions that where everybody really has a seat at the table and an active voice so that we are mitigating all of our own blind spots and really thinking in a transformational way about what our democracy should look like, because it should not look like the democracy that has come before us. And we have to be forging a new vision. So those are my five suggestions there.
Thank you all so much. I think all of those suggestions and ideas about connecting disabled people to their civil rights and access to the polls, I know we're running out of time, but want to ask you a final question. And, you know, we know that there's a lot of problems, but that we've seen some improvements in terms of people accessing the ballot box, but we've also seen a lot of anti-voting laws getting passed that particularly affect disabled people. But Thinking forward, sort of what makes you hopeful in this space? What's keeping you motivated in continuing this work?
Okay, this is Nse. The wins that in spite of it all, in the face of it all, the coalitions that we are part of have been winning. And again, that is partially the impetus for some of the backlash that we're witnessing. I would say the wins. The second thing is the learnings that we're getting smarter and more strategic and more confident. Our rapid response English is hard, is that they are improving, right? That we're building muscle, coalitional muscle, right? Which isn't always easy because ultimately, while we all sort of fall under, or in our coalition in Georgia in particular, civil rights, voting rights, repro rights organizations, we have missions and mandates that don't neatly overlap. And so the idea is that we're figuring out how to work together, and it's getting easier, and we're developing a shared vocabulary, and the trust is being built. And I feel really good about our future.
Oh gosh, that was so good. Oh, good. You go, Doug.
Okay. Yes, it sounded great. I really appreciate what Nse was saying. What gives me hope is the efforts of people like Nse and Mimi and thousands of others who are doing what they can to improve the voting conditions, voting accessibility for people with disabilities. I think there's a lot of reason for hope. One point I wanted to make just quickly is that disability, voting for people with disabilities is not a partisan issue, or it certainly shouldn't be. I mean, some of the current, voting legislation being debated around the country does, of course, have a partisan nature, but people with disabilities are both Republicans and Democrats. In fact, their partisan split is just about the same as in the general population. There are plenty of Democrats and plenty of Republicans out there with disabilities. Both parties have an interest in turning out people with disabilities to vote, making it easier to vote. So it really is not, sometimes people I think might think of it as a partisan issue. It's really, really not. The partisan split is just about identical. I'm very hopeful based on events like this. And let me just tell you, from a personal perspective, when Lisa and I started studying this back in the late 90s, there wasn't a lot of attention to it. There was very little attention to it. We are very gratified that we see events like this. We see tremendous amount of attention by policymakers, politicians as well. So much more than we saw in the late 90s when we started looking at this.
Yeah, I was going to say my optimism is actually kind of a combination of that, I've been in this field for well over a decade now. And I think that conversations like this are relatively new, and they're so important. And I am quite optimistic that we're going to continue to see these sorts of conversations, and that we are going to continue to see the voting rights movement grow and be even more diverse and really have the intersectional quality that our democracy ultimately must incorporate. So that gives me a lot of hope for 2022 and past that.
Amazing. You all, it's just been an amazing conversation to have with you all. Thank you so much to all the panelists for participating and giving us a guide to gaining more curb cuts to the ballot box. This is super extremely important, particularly for the disability community. As a disability community member, I think, thinking about access and ensuring that we protect individuals' basic right to vote is extremely important. We're now going to head over and hear from another voter voice, Shalom Hernandez from Texas.
Hello, my name is Shalom Hernandez. I'm from Texas, and I have black hair with blonde highlights. I'm currently wearing a black blouse. The 2020 election felt different to me because due to COVID, and the sanitation rules that we had to go through, but the process of voting, was similar to how it originally and it has been. What was your voting experience? My voting experience, I'm a person with a physical disability, so it went really well. I didn't have to wait in line, and the poll workers made sure I had an accessible booth so I could vote comfortably, and they followed all the COVID rules. I think it was a good experience, especially for the social and economic situations we were going through as a country. I think that was the urgency for me. There was that urgency for me to make sure that my vote and my voice was heard, because I believe when one votes, you make a difference locally. And then I do believe voting connects you to the community because of the impact you can create. And I believe, you know, voting is extremely important. And what could have made my experience better? There's always, you know, different polling locations, but as a person with a disability, I believe just having, you know, everything made more accessible to individuals with disabilities. I mean, which it already was, but, you know, depending on the disability and provide assistance as needed, it's very important. Thank you.
Hi, everyone. We are going to turn our attention now to hearing experiences from the field. My name is Michelle Bishop. I am the Voter Access and Engagement Manager at the National Disability Rights Network. I am a white woman. I am wearing my signature black rim nerd glasses. I usually have very big, unruly, curly hair. You can't tell today because I pulled it back for you all. And I am sitting in front of my now legendary lime green dining room wall that was featured all over the internet ever since we started working from home in 2020. And I'm going to be talking with today some of our panelists who were doing work in the field or working with our advocates in the field during the last couple election cycles about what we've seen and what we want to see going forward. We heard so much about some of the challenges that voters with disabilities face, as well as some of the progress we've made. And I'm hoping we can maybe do a lightning round where we sum some of that up. And also let's take that hope that we heard from our last panel and talk about how we can turn that into action and what we want to do going forward. So what I'm going to do first is ask each of my panelists, introduce yourselves, of course, but then maybe tell us, what did you see coming out of the 2020 election that you hope continues? What progress have we made that we want to see going forward? Let's have Lilian take it away first.
Awesome. So hi, my name is Lilian, Lilian Aluri. I am a medium brown skin multiracial woman. I have long dark brown hair and bangs, wearing an orange sweater, and behind me is just a wall with shelves and pictures. My pronouns are she, hers, and I am the Rev Up Voting Campaign Coordinator at the American Association of People with Disabilities. Thank you for that question, Michelle. It's really exciting to be in this really important conversation. And to quickly answer the question, Rev Up is a national nonpartisan initiative bringing together state and local and national organizations focused on advancing the disability vote. And one of the main ways that we do that is through grassroots organizing and coalition building at the grassroots level. And so having been able to see and witness the power of grassroots organizers really working in their communities and working with their friends and their neighbors and folks that share their mission of wanting to get out the disability vote and to make sure that we have access to voting was just really powerful. And I think that continued throughout last year. I know that the Georgia SB 202 bill was mentioned, and I think that's a great example of how Georgia advocates were, and Georgia advocates and Rev Up and other groups were working really hard to fight against that bill. And then once it was passed, they're still working to provide testimony in the lawsuit and still advocate against those changes that are really damaging to voting access. So grassroots organizing is kind of my what I would really like to see continue, and I know will continue.
I love it. I love it. Who has thoughts? Maya, you want to take it away?
Sure. I'm happy to. Hi, everybody. My name is Maya Rupert. My pronouns are she, her, hers. I am a dark-skinned Black woman. I wear my hair in long, thin Black braids. I have what you can't really see, but I'm wearing a Black and blue dress today. I am against a pure white wall behind me, and I use my hands a lot when I'm speaking. My background, the last couple of cycles, I've gotten the chance to work on some great campaigns that I'm really, really proud of. I was the campaign manager for Julian Castro in 2020. When we withdrew, I moved over and was a senior advisor for Senator Elizabeth Warren. And just in 2021, I was the campaign manager for Maya Wiley, who ran for mayor of New York City. So I've gotten a chance to work on the campaign side and be one of the people who has benefited from so much of what people are talking about today, the organizing within the community and folks, you know, sort of coming to campaigns and asking that we do better. And I feel like in a lot of ways, I've seen some really great changes. I know there's more to be done, but one thing that I'm really hopeful that I want to see continue is just sort of that partnership. I feel like we got very, very lucky with just some incredible advocates who were reaching out and talking to us about policy things. I think when I think about voting and making sure that folks feel engaged, it's as much, you know, there's the infrastructure of voting rights. There's also making sure that issues that matter to people are getting prioritized. And so it's a policy question. And so we got very lucky with a lot of folks who were willing to engage very closely with our team and the campaign and to make sure that we were talking about the issues that matter most to the community. Rebecca, who's here with us today, was just a constant source and partner for us in so many of the campaigns that I worked on, and I just remain so grateful for that. And I would say, I think there are a couple of small things I was able to like carry on. And one example, it's small, but it actually ended up being really, really helpful for us on the Castro campaign. We had a section on our website where we said, you know, this is accessibility is a priority for us. And if there's something that we're not doing well, please let us know. And we actually did get feedback from that portal. And that was something that when I joined Maya's campaign, we carried on and had that same sort of ask, because I think that essentially it really does that onus of this is somewhere that is going to hear and listen and wants to make sure that the community is engaged is an onus that has to fall to the campaigns. And so being able to do something affirmative like that makes people know, okay, I'm not going to be yelling at a wall. If I say this, this is something that the campaign has chosen to prioritize. So my hope is that there are things like that that we can continue to do on that side to make sure that folks who are wanting to engage and can do it well and in an accessible way.
I'm like holding back my urge to like snap and applaud the whole time you're talking, because we talk so much about how voting can be inaccessible. Our polling places, our voting systems aren't accessible. And that does send a message to people with disabilities that your vote is not welcomed here, it's not important. But whether or not campaigns and candidates speak to you and about your issues, in my mind, is what tells us whether or not our vote matters at all. Right? Whether or not it matters at all that our elected officials are thinking about us and prioritizing our issues. I love it. I'm like, I'm getting jazzed, guys. I'm feeling the hope. Alejandrina, take it away.
Hi, everyone. My name is Alejandrina Guzman. Pronouns are she, her. My audio description is I'm really close to the camera. I have light brown skin, glasses on, black hair, hoop earrings, and a light blue blouse. I love this question. So for the 2020 election cycle, my role there in the campaign, I worked for the Texas Democratic Party as the statewide disability constituency organizer. And I was really lucky to have served in that role because it was the first time ever. And I think there was another state, I don't know if it was Iowa, it was two of us, Texas and another state, that for the first time ever had a disability constituency organizer first. I would love to say that Texas was first. I'm pretty sure we were first by like a month. But it was just incredible, because what I want to see after having done that organizing, and it wasn't just me, right? It was building out the community that had been left out for so long. I mean, campaigns, it has felt like personally that the disability community was often left to the end, or their website didn't have any, you know, kind of accessibility statements. And, you know, 2020 really was different because so many of us in the community all at the same time. And again, acknowledging that This didn't just happen out of nowhere. This has been built upon by, you know, the previous speakers that we had on and other community members that are, you know, watching right now, tuning in right now. And a lot of us commitment. That's what I want to keep seeing is, and that could look in many ways, that can be in many forms. For example, making sure that whatever campaign you're on any outreach you're doing in whatever capacity that you have, that there is budget money set aside purposely for this. I mean, I had to fight to get caption money for me to do my job. And in the beginning, I said, I will not organize until you give me captioning money, right? Like, I had to say that. And after that, I had that budget. But again, one of the main pieces, in addition to community, in addition to, you know, truly making sure that our stories are uplifted, in addition to that, is the money part. And I feel like oftentimes that's also forgotten.
I love how what each of you brought up was essentially either our community, people with disabilities, remaining and increasing our commitment to the vote, and people with disabilities being integrated into the process and our voices being centered in the process of our elections. Because that, to me, more than any one thing, is really what matters, right? We could say like curbside voting is cool, or like drop boxes in 2020 or whatever. And those are true. Those things were great. But that's just one thing that maybe worked for some voters, where it's really people with disabilities being active and our voices being centered and respected in the progress that, in my mind, really drives that long-term change. When we're really, you know, striving for full inclusion and access is just a constant process, right? There's no endpoint. There's no one thing we can do that just magically makes it work. I love that. Let's, one thing you saw coming out of 2020 that you don't ever want to see again. One thing we're going to stop doing. Let's start with Maya this time.
So I want to significantly change cultures in campaigns, in sort of campaign related work. I think that one of the toughest things when we're talking about how do we make sure that folks with disabilities are the ones at the tables making these decisions, one of the hardest things is, I think that we have a culture on a lot of campaigns, and therefore a lot of sort of campaign adjacent work, including voting rights access work, that is, you work at the expense of your health. And it means that folks with disabilities are very often scared out of these jobs or not able to keep these roles in a way that is, it makes our work worse. What we're talking about today is that this only works when folks with disability are part of the teams that are coming up with these solutions. And so we've got to shift that culture, and that culture is deep. That is one of the hardest things. That it's like, I've been on campaigns where I have said, hey, we need to be careful about this. People, you need to tell your supervisor if things are getting too bad, if your mental health is being impacted, if your physical health is being impacted, raise your hand. Obviously, these are not 9-to-5 jobs, but there is room for flexibility, and we should take advantage of that. And even as like the campaign manager, I've gotten pushback from people, which tells me that that culture is so ingrained in the way we think this work has to be done, that I cannot imagine what it would feel like to be an organizer on a team who's dealing with some of this and getting that kind of pushback. And so I want to commit to it. I want people who are trying to do this work to really, really think about how those mentalities show up and what we can do to stop them, because otherwise we are not going to be able to get people who want to do this work to be able to do it.
And people in the chat are with you. If you're not seeing that, they are with you on this one. And can I say, can we just maybe make that something we revise about American culture as a whole? The ideal that we all work until we break and then work a little bit more. It's so unhealthy and such a just terrible, unachievable standard. Agree. Alejandrina, what do you think? Something you don't want to see again.
I retweet everything Maya said. I have a million stories on that. But a different thing that I'll mention for now is what I don't want to see again is, and maybe this was kind of particular for the pandemic, but this, at least in Texas, I don't know how it was everywhere else, but I felt like there was often this fear of disability when vote by mail was being presented as an option. And I understand that the perspective on that was to get more people to, you know, vote by mail, as I'm sure many of you know that Texas is really restrictive. And on top of that, with a new bill that has just passed, but that's another conversation. I don't even know how to piece together my sentences, because many of us, I was angry when I saw how this fear of, like, you know, mark disabled on vote by mail and you should be good. And I don't want to say that, like, I'm no invalidating anyone's experience, but it's just the tone was just off. And when disabled people would point that out or suggest a different type of tone in including everybody, as vote by mail not just being an unnecessary option of many, right? But making sure that people aren't being afraid to become disabled. It was just, I don't know, a complex way to word it out, but I don't want to see that. I when disabled people tell you something, it means something.
Yes. I mean, that's the perfect way to sum that up. I can't think of a better way to sum that up. Yes. Yes. Lilian, what are your thoughts?
Yeah. The biggest thing that comes to mind is something that's been a topic of, you know, this whole event today, which was the backlash of voting restrictions following such an amazing and record-breaking turnout in the 2020 elections. And it's probably too much to ask that not happen again. But the way that increased voter turnout, which should be something to celebrate, turned into a slew of laws and bills to make it harder for people to vote and decrease access to the ballot is just really an abomination when I think about the direction we want to go with our democracy. So,
yes, there's one last question I wanted to ask you all. Then that's kind of maybe why we talked about those things we don't want to see again, is what do we do about it? I love how the last conversation ended with everyone talking about how they really do feel hopeful about where we're going and what's to come in the future, which I think is important, right? Especially the last couple of years, not just elections, but all around, the last couple of years have been rough, right? Here we are in the middle of a global pandemic. It's been rough. That hope matters. How do we translate that into action? What are we going to do about all of this? What is the next step? Let's start with you, Alejandrina. What do you think?
This is Alejandrina speaking. Okay, many things. But one I'll mention is and I think many of us have said this already, to ensure that all the pieces of commitment of including disabled stories, of including disabled people in the decision-making process. And a lot of this, many of us already know, and we fight for, whether it's on social media or at the, you're the boss, right? Campaign manager, you're still fighting for it, right? Like, main thing is that as we keep continuing building community, that we just keep going. Oh, that's I don't know how to word that, but I'm very hopeful though, because we disabled people have always been here, and we'll keep being here. And as we continue to just be present, right, and ensure that we're not afraid to say what we say, and I think many of us already are that way, that things can get better. And I don't want to mix it into a toxic positivity kind of way. I want to frame it more as, like, you know, we got this, right? Like, we're all in this together.
That's real. That is so real. And it's hard. It's hard not to fall into that like toxic positivity and all that. I get it. But it's like, you know, first of all, nobody is going to come change things for us, right? No, if we're not speaking up for ourselves, I don't know that it's going to happen. And also, I don't know if this is toxically positive, but I believe in us. We are a strong people. We have been fighting and we've come this far. I agree. We got this. I mean, we can do it. Absolutely. Lilian.
This is Lilian. Building a bit on what Alejandrina was saying, the way that we're going to do this is by expanding our coalitions, by working together with folks. One of the things that's come up earlier is that, you know, the disability community in America, we're not a distinct community from everyone else. We are a part of and in every other community. You know, we are also Asian and Black and women and LGBTQ. And so the opportunity, there's so much opportunity there to combine resources and experience to tackle what is really some really big challenges that have been added on to in this past year to get out voters and to make sure that voters in all of our communities have access to the ballot. And so that's what I know there will be more of. That's what we're working towards. I just think that that's going to be the way that we ensure that our democracy actually works for all of us.
Maya, take us home.
I would just add to that, we're going to be creative. I think that is that when we sort of content ourselves with the idea that this is the business of, you know, how voting access works, this is the business of how campaigns work, and this is the way it's always been done, then yes, we're going to see a lot of roadblocks to why we can't make it more accessible. But if we're willing to think creatively, you know, and it's simple stuff, it's like, you know, can we not give people daily goals or requirements, instead give weekly, so that people can say for themselves, later in the week tends to be harder for me, so I'm going to front load my work. Like, are there simple things we can do like that so that people can figure out what works best for them and still get done what needs to happen? But then there's, I think, bigger systemic things that we can think more creatively about the way we do some of this work. Because again, it's a lot of times the answer to why do we do it this way is literally because that's the way we've always done it. It's not because we think it's the best. It's not because technology hasn't changed things. It's not because we genuinely all like it that way. It's that that was how we learned it. And so we just keep doing it. And there are so many changes, I think, that can help us to make these spaces healthier and more accessible and therefore more inclusive and better. We will do our work better. Those things don't have to stand in contrast to each other. And I think just being honest about it and talking about it, just saying out loud sometimes, hey, look, I know everybody's working really, really hard. Please, if you're done at 4 o'clock today, don't just start the next project just to prove something. Take the rest of the day off because you're going to be working on Saturday. Something that simple, but like saying it out loud is very often the difference between continuing a really toxic culture and letting people remember that they're humans at the end of that. And that makes our work better. And I think that shifting this idea that we have that it's like, we can either work all the time or we can do this work well, those things are not actually in contradiction, but we tell ourselves that they are and we believe in it. And we've just become so addicted to this culture. And I think that we can break it, but I don't think we're going to do it unless we do it together.
Yeah. Oh my gosh. I feel that. Like, I feel like as disabled people, I feel like we constantly hear, we can't do that, or we're not going to do that right now. I feel like we're just constantly being asked to wait, and it's going to be more inclusive and more accessible and better in the future. And I'm just tired of waiting, right? What are we waiting for? Accessibility, inclusion. These aren't things that are nice to do. They're a need to do. It's not optional. It's not optional. This is about our rights. This is about our access to our communities and to live, work, and play in our communities. It's just, it's not an option. We've been waiting long enough. Y'all, I'm getting so much energy from this conversation. Thank you so much for having this discussion with me. It was such an honor to get to talk to you all today and just learn from your experience and get your energy and talk about what we're going to do in the future to just keep moving forward. We've made a lot of progress. Yeah, we're seeing that pushback like we talked about today, but we know we got this and we're not stopping and we're going to keep moving forward. And I love it. Thank you all so much for having this conversation with me today. And speaking of energy, I'm going to pass off to Rebecca Coakley with the Ford Foundation.
Thank you so much, Michelle. Wow. That's the sum up I have for everything I've heard today. Just wow. Hi, it's Rebecca Coakley from Ford again. What an incredible series of conversations. First thing I would say in response to the most recent remarks by Maya is all of you that are watching this, please eat lunch today. Make sure you eat lunch. If you know anything about me, it's that every day between 12 and 2, I send out a Twitter reminder to the disability community to eat lunch. Eating lunch should not be an act of revolution. It should be something that we all do. And so please make sure that you're taking care of yourselves in this moment, in this time. I was trying to think about how to wrap up this event. And I found myself last night turning to Dr. Keisha Blaine's new book on Fannie Lou Hamer. And in the book, one of the quotes that they use is when Fannie Lou said, "If I fall, I'll fall 5 feet, 4 inches forward in the fight for freedom." And falling was a reality for Fannie Lou. As a lifelong voting rights activist, democracy crusader, just civil rights badass, most people don't realize that Fannie Lou Hamer did all of that living with polio. And her story to me always serves as a poignant reminder that people with disabilities do exist across all of our movement spaces and can drive the change within movement spaces that are not defined by the white dude in the wheelchair against the blue backdrop. Continuing to fight though for maximum accessibility for people with disabilities makes voting better for everyone. And expanding access to our democracy is key, both to the disability rights community, but also to the preservation of our democracy. You know, the last piece that I would leave you all with in this moment is thinking as ahead to 2022, is the fact that we have 10 million newly disabled people in the United States alone. 10 million people who are living with the effects of long-term COVID, who are figuring out how to move about the space with an impact to their physical or mental health and well-being that they previously had not experienced. And so when we think about what our democracy needs to look like going forward, let's also keep in mind what we can do now as we move forward to make sure that those folks, when it comes time to access the polls, benefit from the work that's been done, but are also at the table helping drive the change for what needs to happen going forward. I think more than anything, 2021 has really served as a reminder of the power and the strength of the disability rights movement. It's a year where we saw Free Britney, and Free Britney has existed for decades prior to the emancipation of the guardianship of Britney Spears. It has existed going back to the beginning days of institutionalization of disabled people. But what most people don't realize is the number one reason that people fight to remove guardianship, if you ask them, is because people with disabilities under guardianship want to be able to access their right to vote. And guardianship prohibits them from being able to do so. So yet again, that continued thread around being able to access a fundamental right and being prevented from doing so as a result of the label of disability, or the perception that that label means that you are unable to or should be prevented from being able to access a fair and private vote. So in conclusion, you know, what we heard is that the community will continue to fight in all different ways until all of us can access a fair and private vote. And we really look forward to partnering with our friends in the civic engagement and democracy space to continue driving to a more accessible, inclusive, and just democracy for everyone. I want to thank our tremendous panelists today, my amazing co-host, Erica Wood, our CEO, Darren Walker, our captioners, and Ford's events team, who continue to make disability events look so good. And encourage you all to have a lovely rest of the week. Have a great day. Bye-bye.